I said, I'm sorry, brother. Don't apologize. In the world, I've only gotten drunk maybe two or three times when I was raised in a Christian family. But, you know, you get that buzz that you try to maintain. You don't want to get too just, and I feel it in the spirit. I just feel like that nice, low-level, sustained buzz right now. It feels good. I almost just want to sit here and stand here and do nothing, but I know God wants me to share something. I want to pray a prayer. I want to pray a prayer of Paul. You don't have to turn there. I'm going to read it. We're going to pray it. And then we'll see what God has to say. I'm too vain to actually buy real glasses. I'm going to keep on flip-flopping. I like the other. Let's pray. Father, we ask you that the God of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of glory, may give to us the Spirit of wisdom and revelation in the knowledge of you. Father, I ask you in the mighty name of Jesus that the eyes of our understanding being enlightened, that we may know what is the hope of his calling, what are the riches of the glory of his inheritance in the saints, what is the exceeding greatness of his power toward us who believe, according to the working of his mighty power, which he worked in Christ when he raised him from the dead, seated him at his right hand in the heavenly places, far above all principality and power and might and dominion and every name that is named,
yes,
including lymphoma, not only in this age, but also in that which is to come. And he put all things under his feet and gave him to be heard head over all things to the church, which is his body, the fullness of him who fills all in all. Hallelujah forevermore. I'll be flip-flopping these glasses here tonight. You know, what I'm going to share tonight, frankly, I'm not exactly how the Holy Spirit's going to express this. I'm just trusting the Lord that he'll fill my mouth. I've never shared it in this venue before. I just want to say that Brother Larry and Brother Steve and Brother Landon are men of God that I truly treasure. They're blood brothers, and we walk in agreement. But the Lord has given me a little peek behind the curtain. Hey! And it's completely flipped me out. I mean, I'm really. If you would have known me before, you would have known I was already flipped out. But I am really flipped out. I am more in love with Jesus. I am more in awe of him. Every day, it literally feels like Christmas. I'm telling you, I feel like I live like every day is Christmas. I cannot believe that God sustained me, that I could be home with my wife and my kids, that I could love on my babies. I see Jesus in them, the joy of the Lord. But beyond the wonder of the family, God is taking me into a wonder of his sovereignty. And this is not just a message. This is not his principles. This is not just reading Isaiah 45 and Romans 9. By the way, you might want to pen those down and ask the Lord for some revelation. Because in every denomination or camp or expression, whatever you want to word, there is truth. Baptists have truth. Presbyterians have truth. Lutherans have truth. Catholics even have some truth. Pentecostals have some truth. But when it's all said and done, there's only going to be one kingdom.
Right.
It's the stone kingdom in Daniel that's going to crush all of the kingdoms. And by his grace, we're going to be part of his kingdom.
Yes.
And I just want to go as low as possible so I can get to that first resurrection that Paul was talking about. You see, when I'm in... For those who don't know me, I've been raised. My first memory in life, I'll just share this briefly because I've heard it already, is the Holy Spirit. And I can say by the grace of God that I am a chosen vessel. That's just the grace of God. I can't boast of that. And when I was about 2, my mom would sing Away in the Manger. I'd cry myself to sleep with Jesus. I had no crib for a bed. And the Holy Spirit would just come on me, and I'd feel the manifest presence of the Lord at the age of 2. And I got filled with the Holy Ghost at 11, started speaking in tongues. And then the glory of God came in my room 21 years ago and nearly killed me. I mean, the bright light that Saul, who became Paul, and the count that Moses had, I just cried. I said, God, Moses saw your glory. I want to see your glory. And completely, it was the most terrible, awesome, reverential fear of the Lord and the most awesome, unconditional love at the same time. I can't even explain it. As my life literally was leaving my body, I couldn't breathe. I couldn't move. I was curled up in a ball because when the light came in, I jumped off onto the floor, on the bed. I curled in a ball. I blocked my face. I put my face down in the mattress just to protect myself. And I was ducking for cover. So I've been pretty whacked out for the last 21 years. I mean, what really competes with that? I mean, what do? You know, there's no 5 points and, you know, what color is your parachute? Don't cut it anymore. I mean, I'm not, you know, I don't have a career. It's all Jesus. I'm all in. How many are all in tonight? How many are all in? I'm going to say you're all in whether you know it or not. Hallelujah. So my journey, having been raised in a very, how do I put it? Not UPC Pentecost, but German missionaries. They came from Germany. They were real. There was a lot of legalism. Holiness unto the Lord. They would sing these like Nazi type songs. And, you know, holiness unto the Lord. As you, and I'm part German, so I can say that. So. But they knew the flow of the Spirit and the liberty of God. So there was a lot of mixture that I was raised in. And a lot of mixture. You know, this church age is full of mixture. Pentecost is 3 main feasts. There's Passover, Pentecost, and Tabernacles. And if we study those feasts, we'll get an idea of what God's plan is through the ages. Passover was fulfilled at the cross. Pentecost was fulfilled 2,000 years ago when the fire came down. But there's a remnant that's going to cross into Tabernacles. And that's if you've been touched by the Holy Ghost, you are room for life. You'll be never satisfied with this flesh here. You'll never be satisfied because Pentecost ain't cutting it. Pentecost was never designed to cut it. If it was going to happen, it would have happened the last 2,000 years. The move of God that we're all talking about, this glory, is in the next age. But I have good news for you. We're really close. We're really close. And I'm going to share some things as God has opened up my eyes to just how close we are. And he's given me a peek at the man behind the curtain. The one who's been pulling the strings all along. The one who's in complete control of everything. Not only does he know the number of the hairs of your head, he counts them one by one as you lose them. He knows everything. Not only does he know everything, he's ordained everything. And this is the journey I've been on, especially the last 3 years. Now, how many have had these coincidences in your walk with the Lord where you'll share a Bible verse or you'll tell a testimony? Or it could be not even something spiritual. It could be something odd. You could be talking about cows and all of a sudden there's a milk commercial on TV. Or you could be talking about, a white Mercedes Benz, and all of a sudden there's a white Mercedes Benz commercial. Or you could be just having a conversation, and all of a sudden there's a billboard exactly what you're talking about, or someone just stepped into the house. I mean, we would just talk. How many have had those? Okay, those are glimpses. Tonight you're about to get awakened. You see, it's not about revival anymore. It's truly about a great awakening. We're truly about to be awakened. And wherever I share this message, just one-on-one, I haven't shared it publicly, just one-on-one, all of a sudden I sit down, watch, things are going to start happening. There's an impartation of awakening. He's been in control all along. We just haven't known it. We say we know it, but we really don't know it. You know, revelation is like layers of an onion. You just keep on peeling and peeling and peeling and peeling. All of a sudden, it's like, you know, brother, how many times God drops something to your spirit, and then a month later, he said the same thing, but it just went deeper. It's just deeper. It's the same word, but it's just deeper. That's what's been going on. It's been really, really tricky. Well, I'm going to share with you tonight. I want you to pray this prayer. Just put your hand on your heart. Only if you really want to know truth. If not, don't do it. Say, Lord Jesus, make me childlike. Because your word says that I have to become like a child to enter into your kingdom. So remove every obstacle and give me eyes to see and give me ears to hear. Just like one of Brother Stephen's little boys or Brother Vinny's little kids that just believe their daddy. Just become like, I want to be like the child. Tell them that. That's it. Amen. Hallelujah. My journey in life has never been to be a preacher, a minister. When you're wrecked at the age of 2, all I want to know is God. That is my journey in life. I just want to know him. And somehow, by his grace, he has taken care of all the other stuff that so many people in the world worry about. Finances, mates, raising kids. I don't know how the heck it's gotten done. Brother Steve was at my 50th birthday party in St. Louis. I ministered a conference up there. Had some good friends and my family. And with tears in my eyes, everybody started sharing. It was a wonderful time. With tears in my eyes, I just started sharing about my life. And I look back at my childhood. I look back even the dealings of God. I'm not talking about just blessing. It's all blessing. Does it feel like you're in blessing, but you're being blessed? In fact, I'm a little jealous of Steve because some areas he's waiting for, and then God, in the last couple of years, blessed me in certain areas, and he's still waiting, and he's blessed in certain areas. I said, brother, I'm jealous because the last shall be first, so I can't wait, brother. I'm telling you, the glory is going to be nuts. The blessing is going to be off the chart because that's how God works. So if you've been waiting, you've just been like feeling God's forgotten about you. I'm telling you, you're in the crucible of affliction because he is working such an exceeding weight of glory in your life by his sovereign hand. But here's the revelation, folks. And it's okay wherever we're all at. It's okay. I've learned. Well, no, I'm still learning. Because when God drops the truth on me, I get real passionate. I get crazy. And sometimes I try to force feed people. You've never done that. You've never had a bunch of anointing, just slap hands on everybody and everything that moved. Dogs, cats, you know, in-laws, mother-in-laws, outlaws. Dang it! You know, it's like, right? Well, you got a nugget, you just got to tell the whole world. Well, this has been digesting now for the last 3 years, and God saw it fit to have Brother Landon come, invite me. In fact, he invited me last year, and I didn't feel the release to come, because I was still, this is germinating, and I was just chewing on it and digesting it, trying to assimilate this and all the other truths that God's given me about pressing in and confessing the word. I believe all that. I want you to know that I believe all that. But he's given me a peek at the man behind the curtain. So let me continue. Let me share. Where do I start, Father? Because I just really want to testify about, when I finished my testimony, when I look back at my life, all I said, it was the grace of God. There was nothing that I could boast in. I don't feel like I earned anything. It's not false humility. It's the absolute truth. My wife, my kids, the dealings of God, taking me out of a career, taking me, breaking me, supernaturally providing, going through bankruptcy. I'm talking about the whole nine yards. Not just talking about the mountaintops. I'm talking about the deep, deep valleys. Every ministry's of deep, deep valleys. That's the grace of God. It's all the grace of God. The most heinous act ever committed was the cross. The most violent, brutal, heinous act, yet it was the grace of God. The word for grace, there's a science called gematria. It's the study of biblical numbers. And I've been around some men that have shown me some things. The Bible says every jot and tittle, everything is going to be fulfilled. Everything. Well, Hebrew and Greek are also, in those cultures, numerical systems. Numbering systems. A is 1, B is 2, C is 3, so on and so forth. They're a little bit different. So gematria is a study of decoding the words in the language. Because God is the ultimate mathematician. He's the ultimate quantum physicist. I mean, he's created it all. So once your eyes start getting open to a brand new side of God, it's like, whoa, this is really tripped out. I'm just warming up. Trust me, this is going to get really trippy. You're taking whatever that, what was the pill in the Matrix? They're taking that pill. That's the pill. Whatever Neo took, that's the pill. You're getting force-fed the pill tonight. Hey. Hallelujah. So where was I? Tell me. So anyway, 911, when you grace in the Greek, when you add up the letters in Greek, it comes to 911. 9-11. Also in Hebrew, in the beginning is 9-11. God prophesied 6,000 years ago about 9-11. There's another man, his name is Jonathan Cahn. And I brought this, but I don't think I'm going to go that time. Who's heard of Jonathan Cahn? He is a spirit-filled Jew that has a church in New Jersey. And he's given him the same kind of revelation that Jones and Oja has about the uncanny, miraculous sovereignty of God in events, where God is speaking and they're declaring. I mean, everything that happened on 9/11. Just Google Jonathan Cahn, K-A-H-N, the Harbinger. You can get his book. I think you can watch it. I had a little bit, but we're not going to go there tonight. And what God is showing some of these new friends of mine and myself and other people in the body is this unveiling. The sovereignty of God is no longer just a message. It's a reality. And once you have that reality, there's no more, hey! There's no more fear. There's no more fear. There's no more striving. There is no more pressing in, because we are already in. But see, when I'm in the islands with Brother Larry someday, maybe I just prophesied, I'm going to show him how to break through. You see, it's both. It's both. See, we got to stop fighting over stuff. We have to embrace both. It's the free will of man and the sovereignty of God, two tracks on one train with the destination already pre-planned. Already pre-planned. You see, actually, there's a man in my life named James Brueggemann. There's three guys, Stephen Jones, Ron Oge, and James Brueggemann. And these guys could be as opposite from me as possible. And they're becoming friends, and what's happened is, I through a divine appointment, I met Stephen Jones a little over 3 years ago. And he came in, and one of the things he was looking for, a prophetic sign, it'll all make sense, so just go with me. God used me to prophesy in the teaching that night in 2 Kings 4 with the woman with the vessels. And it was one of the signs of Elisha. There was a prophetic word that came forth about the signs of Elisha. And the ninth sign is, how many dinar owners do we have here? Iraqi dinar, okay. Is the multiplication of bread, which we believe is the reevaluation of the dinar. We've been stuck on this eighth sign now for about a year and a half or so. But I believe we're real close, so I'm going to share some of that as well. But anyway, the Lord has given me a tremendous peek behind the curtain. And those coincidences that we shared earlier are little glimpses. They're little glimpses. He's even doing it in the world. I was watching a show on TV called, it's where they mob you. Mobbed? Called Mob? Flash Mob. It's Mob with Howie Mandel. And they set up a scene, and let's say somebody wants to get married, and they set up, like, who knows what these flash mobs are? They just start singing in the malls, and all of a sudden people are breaking out and dancing. It's kind of crazy, right? Well, they planned this in advance. And it was weird. Right on camera, they were planning a specific dance because this woman was going to tell her husband that she's pregnant. And so they just said, you know, we're thinking about doing a dance with strollers. Okay? I know it sounds crazy. I know it sounds out there. Just go with me. And he said, yeah, we get them again. And all of a sudden, there was a whole group of moms, this was not planned, that were exercising around the malls, doing exercises with the strollers. And Howie, and this was not planned, he's like, now that was weird. You see, I believe God's given them a glimpse. They call it faith, they call it synchronicity. I call it God, they just don't know it yet. You see, God is in complete control. Now, how do I want to do this, Father? I'll just share my testimony. So 3 years ago, we're going. Remember, we go up to Six Flags in Atlanta. Okay, there's about, and I'm driving up the car. I'm not being spiritual. I'm not pressing in. There's no worship on. I got the kids screaming in the car. We're going on vacation. Brother Landon, Brother Steve, you feel me? All of a sudden, the glory of God descends on me in the car. And, you know, I'll go, whoa! Only this was yes from my toes. Yes! And I'm just going, I'm screaming yes. I'm having a meltdown. The power of God's all over me. I'm shaking. I'm like, honey, I got to pull over. I start crying and laughing like a schoolgirl. I mean, I don't know. I mean, my emotions are completely shot. I'm shaking like a leaf. And I said, it's happening. It's happening now. I don't even know what's happening. I just know it's happening. And I'm screaming, it's happening. It's happening now. I mean, it's just bizarre. I mean, it's just crazy. Then I start doing like this crazy, like Holy Ghost kind of stuff. I'm in the car. Crazy. Yeah, I'm crazy. That's right. It's okay. You know I'm crazy. I know I'm crazy. And my daughter is very, very prophetic. She started prophesying at the age of 9. She prophesied a paint off the wall when the Spirit of God's on. Just amazing prophetic gift. And I immediately said, honey, what is the Lord telling you that I'm doing? And within a few seconds, she says, I see lightning coming from your hands. And God's releasing angels all over the world. And see, Larry, that's breakthrough. I'm all about breakthrough. The anointing on my life, and Larry's, and Steve, and Landon is about breakthrough. And tonight, you're going to get breakthrough into a whole other place. This is breakthrough. And right after that, about a month, Dr. Stephen Jones puts me on his website to sell Iraqi dinar. Sovereign, divine meeting through a pastor friend that I just stayed in touch because he had gotten hurt and he was out of the church. I just kind of loved on him, and then he invited me. You see, and had I had any pride or resistance, had there been any religious in me, he said, you know what, I know what this guy's about. This is heresy, and I don't know about this dude. He's all in his head. They're like, God, that's not my flow. I would have missed the greatest blessing of my life. But God set it up just at the right time so I could receive and have enough grace to go there. Because that whole flow is really way out of my comfort zone. I mean, way out. These guys, I mean, let's just dance in the glory all day, you know? That thing, that was a stretch. How many people say it's good to be stretched? You see? I'm telling you, I would have missed one of the greatest blessings of my life. And this, what I love about these guys, is that they have more revelation in their pinky than I have in my whole body. But they notice the gift of God in my life, and see real revelation, should cause you to go lower. You see, and the ultimate revelation is the sovereignty of God. Because when you know that 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 you have nothing to do with this thing, there is no place for pride. But if we think we got something to do with this thing, I got news for you folks. Nobody's getting into that tabernacle's age. Well, you'll get it eventually. It won't be the first resurrection. You'll have to wait in the grave, whatever God's going to do. Well, Jones can tell you the plan. That's not my deal. But here's the thing. I want to get in. I've waited too long, I've hungered too long, I've died to too much stuff, I've been through too much rejection, humiliation, breaking, you name it, to miss the mark. Right. And in Jesus' name, I won't miss it and you won't miss it. But I'm telling you, you've got to listen. Because Pentecost is 11 feasts. As long as we're in this suit, we're in mixture. death is in this flesh. And God uses it to break us. It's his plan. This is his ultimate plan. But there's a remnant that God is going to cause to cross over. And I'm telling you, we are really, really close. We are really, really close. You don't want to miss this part. Brother Larry, you ain't seen nothing yet. You think gold teeth and feathers is cool? Brother, you ain't seen nothing yet. And God uses this man in signs and wonders. And all of us have been used in some kind of miraculous way, as many of you. But you ain't seen nothing yet. But here's the thing. The word Canaan, how many know Canaan is associated with the promised land? Right? Okay. In the Old Testament, it was a literal place. It was filled with giants, obstacles to overcome. It was a literal place. In the New Covenant, our brand new bodies are the promised land. 1 Corinthians 15, this flesh, this corruption will take on incorruption. This mortality will take on immortality. Right now, the Bible says in Pentecost, we just have a deposit. We have a pledge. We have an earnest. That's it. We were sealed with a pledge. But we got so many people puffed up about their pledge, they're not seeing the whole picture. Yeah, we can do some stuff. We can prophesy. We can touch God. We can lay hands on the sick. You know, sometimes it works, sometimes it won't. But let me tell you something. When we cross over to the fullness, oh my goodness. Oh, it's going to be a party. And we'll all be attached to one head. So whose thoughts are that? Whose will is that? Whose emotions are that? There's only one head on this body. Amen. See, we've had a two-headed monster for too long. God has given me a glimpse by his grace. Because there was a woman of God named Ziggy Omblader about 10 or 12 years ago. And she prophesied over me about humility. And I've been trying to humble myself and repent when I repent and staying low. But you know what? Only God can truly humble you. And the only way God humbles you, it's by his sovereign grace that he reveals that he's in complete control. Now, dude, that's humility. Now, this is going to be an extreme truth. Because you've gotten all the other stuff for years from Brother Landon. So I'm not here to do that. Because we got that already. God's bringing me here to bring this. And you know what, Brother Landon? You'll find the balance. You clean up the mess. Thank God I'm not pastor anymore. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Second Timothy 3:16. You don't have to turn there. All scripture. Everybody say all scripture. Everybody say all scripture. Is given by inspiration of God. And is profitable. For doctrine. For reproof. For correction. For instruction. In righteousness. Why we have so many denominations of denominations? Because everybody's camped on a particular truth. And they have not seen the harmony in Scripture. So they're just stuck on their truth. It's not allowed anymore to park at a particular truth and dig your heels in when there's clearly another truth in that word that seemingly contradicts that truth. They must harmonize. So I got to get in line with God. If I dig my heels in and say, well, says I got this part. It says I choose it. Yes, I agree. But there's another side to this. Let me ask you a question. Whose will is greater? My will, your will, or God's will? Yeah, we say that, but do we really believe it? We say a lot of things, but do we really believe it? Or sometimes we really believe stuff, but we don't say it. Oh. You know, we may ruffle too many feathers. The offerings may start coming in, or I may lose some friends, or whatever it is. We are coming to an hour now that we are required by the Holy Ghost to speak the whole truth and nothing but the truth. Amen. So help us God. Amen. Now, God will direct us by the Holy Spirit, depending on what our audience is. Because when I go into the Jones camp or the Brueggemann guys, or another word camp, I go around those guys, I tell them, we got to press in. We can't just, you know, look at dates all the time. You know, I tell these guys, I love them. You know, we're just sitting here looking at dates. That's, you know, come on. Let's raise our hands. Let's press in. Let's worship God. Come on. There is a present glory that God wants you to have now. Not everything is in the future. He is the great I am. He is the great I am. Here's the balance. Here's the extreme. Our religion puts everything in the past and the future. And I agree. Religion can do that. And now faith is. I preached it. Now faith is. I am. I'm healed now by the stripes. There's a little thing called timing that the church does not have a clue on. So some religious folks can put everything in the future and the past, but crybabies want everything now. Now, 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 now. Listen. Press into God. Believe now. But know that He's in control of the timing. Here's the balance. Though He slay me, yet will I trust Him. That's the balance. I will lay hands on the sick. I will believe they recover. Some of us are dealing with issues in our body. We're believing God for healing. But if it takes away your worship, your praise, your thanksgiving, you better repent. That's the balance. In everything. God showed me in everything, give thanks. In everything. Brother Steve is going through a fiery trial, but the grace of God is on him to give thanks. Count all joy when you go through various trials and temptations, knowing the trying of your faith worketh patience. Oh, that's been, humility and patience. God's been killing me for a decade with those two. And let patience have its perfect work, that you will be complete and lack nothing. Well, faith is a gift. Patience is a fruit. The very word denotes time. Patience doesn't happen overnight. It's the trial of fire. It's the furnace of affliction. That's what works patience. Works long suffering. These are messages you're not going to get on TBN, folks. You're going to get it right here. These men of God walk in it. They walk in this. So God's going to bring us into the balance, but I want to give you just my testimony tonight. Is that okay? After I had a complete meltdown. You know, it's so funny. I got around these guys, and I was so impressed with the humility. I tell you why, because I'm telling you, I call them word nerds. These guys are geniuses. They see stuff and layers, and then when the word's not enough, they go to the Greek. When the Greek's not enough, they go to the numbers. I'm like, what the Dutch? That's the phrase this kid came up with. It's not a bad word. It's actually prophetic. Ron will tell you that one. The whole Jonah thing coming out of the Netherlands. Anyway, hallelujah. And so, but I'm so impressed that Brother Stephen saw something in me that said, you know what? We don't have the whole thing. You know, this is a seasoned man of God. He's got an international ministry. He says, we don't have it. He takes a young guy. I'm getting older now. You know, just an obscurity in my home. He says, come on, we're going to do a conference together called the Quail and Manna. I'm like, he says, you have something we need. They have something we need. It's time we let down our pride. It's time we let down our walls. It's time we became like children. You know, does he have all the revelation? No. Do I have it? No. Does Brother Land have it? No. But together, we're going to have something special. And now God raised up a man named Jonathan Kahn, who's on a public platform. I was watching his inaugural prayer. Did you see that? Oh, man. And he's saying stuff that these guys have been saying in relative obscurity. And now he's on a public platform declaring the sovereign God in signs and wonders. It's just tripping me out. I mean, it's awesome. Listen, the gospel is more glorious than you ever dreamed. God is more loving, more merciful than you ever dreamed. He's better and gooder than you could ever imagine. And he's in more control than you ever dreamed. I'm telling you. If we look at a fantasy movie, let's say Narnia, kids like Narnia, or Lord of the Rings, and we think that somehow that fantasy is better than the kingdom you already deceived, because that's some cool stuff. I can use it. It's going to be a whole cooler thing than that. Amen. And it's going to be tripped out. It's just that religion has blinded us. Traditions, or as Ron says, the traditions of men. fact, every time I get around this guy, I either got to poop or pee. And I'm telling you, he's got some kind of crazy deliverance thing. I said, Ron, I got to hold on. I got to go to the bathroom. I'm telling you, it's crazy. Every time, I don't think I miss the time where I'm peeing. And sometimes I got to call him back because it'll take a little while. It's crazy. I'm a free dude. Try it sometime. It's funny. Hallelujah. We're just too wrapped up too tight. Hallelujah. So I go to this Quail and Manna conference, and Brother Larry, I'm believing for breakthrough. And I'm feeling the resistance in the spirit. You know, not from those guys, they invited me, but some of the people, you can feel it. You know when you're in it, you know when you're in a place where God's got you to break through and you're plowing in the spirit? That's what's going on. I'm plowing. I'm getting headaches, I'm getting attacks in the brain. Joy and I are like, what the heck? We're praying, clean the blood, pressing in. We're believing for breakthrough. And God gave me, Brother Stephen gave me 3 nights. Started sharing my testimony. Second night, we did worship. The third night, bodies were flying everywhere. Were any of you guys at those meetings? It was so powerful. Didn't even have to touch most folks. Just walk by them, we're blowing them. Just power of God. Boom, 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 boom. So I was co-laboring. I was pressing in. I was believing God. But God gave me a peek behind the curtain. See, I can't boast in that anymore. I can't. It's all done. It's done. He will share his glory with no one. And if you want to enter the promised land of a brand new body, this side of the millennium, not after the 1,000 years are up, time to get with the program. Now, some of you need to get to the program because you have this revelation, but you've been holding back your heart and emotions. Oh, you thought you were going to escape. Nobody's escaping tonight. You've been just writing notes and taking notes and looking at blogs all day, but have you been worshiping? Have you been spending time with the Holy Ghost? Have you been pressing into Jesus? Hey! Hey! See, it's both. If Dr. Jones knew, they needed both. Right? You need both. My words are spirit, and they are life. You cannot have a word before you have a breath. And he is a word that became flesh and dwelt among us. And the quail and the manna. The quail is the meat of the word, and the manna is the presence. And unbeknownst to me, here I am, I'm just so blessed and God's moving. But see, in the kingdom, it's a win-win. In kingdom, it's a cross-pollination. And all of a sudden, Jehovah Sneaky's just started coming and started, well, I started seeing stuff. I started looking at stuff a different way. And all of a sudden, these supernatural manifestations that are about to share with you started taking place. Here's the one. Well, let me just share this. After that meltdown in the car 3 years ago, I stepped into the greatest financial blessing of my life. I was the youngest municipal bond broker in Wall Street history. I was making pretty good money at the age of 21. That was 27 years ago. God called me out of that, almost like an audible voice who was sharing, positioned me, and it's been a bloody faith journey for the last 28 years. That's it. Then I had a business with my dad. I walked away from that. Then I went bankrupt and all this stuff. So I've been really just I'm talking about Raymond showing up and a check in the mail and just barely making it with a wife and soon to be 8 kids. And 2.5 years ago, after I had that sovereign meltdown in the car, God gave me favor with Stephen Jones, put me on a website, and I sold this currency all over the world. I made more money in the last 2.5 years than I made in the last 25. Now I'm in another transition. Okay, a lot of that was sown, and we believe in God, and that vein is dried up, and that's why I believe we're about to see the revaluation. But my faith is not in the revaluation. Right. If it never revalues, it's not going to change me. It's not going to make a bit of difference. God can do whatever he wants, whatever he wants, however he wants. So let me start sharing my testimony with you, signs and wonders. How many know signs and wonders follow you? We don't go looking for signs and wonders. They follow you. Say they follow me.
Follow me.
Okay. About not quite 2 years ago, I had a dream. Martin Luther King wasn't the only one. I just tease with you guys. In the dream, my wife grabs me. She's really excited. She's pumped. Honey, I want you to play this game. And she pulls me up to what looks like a pinball machine. And as soon, even before I started playing, ding, 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 you know, those pinballs go up, machines go up. You won, right? It goes, and on the LED screen was 999, 999, 999, 999. Four sets of three nines. Everybody got that? Each word then immediately changed to dinar. D-I-N-A-R. It's the name for the currency in Iraq and some of the Middle Eastern countries. The Spanish is dinero. In the Greek, it's denarius, which we'll get into that if the Lord allows, about the loaves and the fishes. 200 pennies worth, 200 pence. That word is denarius, where we get dinar from, and dinero. And immediately I woke up, and God gave me interpretation. Nine is fruitfulness. Three is completion. Four is harvest, and 12 is government. All those numbers were in that dream. It's the divine government coming on the earth with all of the wealth and resources needed to reap a harvest in complete fruitfulness. That's the dream. And that's what we're about to step into. See, God didn't give the dream for me so I can have my little breakthrough. We have to start, we have to stretch our vision. Being around these guys has stretched my vision for my breakthrough and my personal finances or my healing and my. These guys talk about, you know, mystery Babylon and the Fed and China and dragons and I'm like this. But what I love is the view is so expansive. It's not about my little church and my little region. It's a global kingdom view. We have to expand ourselves. And yes, we can have this expanse, and then it comes right back to a local level. It's both. But to see God move. We did a prophetic act. These guys do prophetic acts. It's a little different. They're a crazy, quirky bunch. I tell them right to their face. We're like, you missed that one. We go to the Fed. This is in this past October when I had my birthday and we ministered. Steve was there. Awesome man of God ministered. And we went to the Fed in St. Louis and all these different, the Federal Reserve Bank. And they did these prophetic acts. One guy took some water from the Mississippi. One guy, I don't know how, I forget. It was bizarre. I'm like, all right, this is a stretch. I'll kind of flow with this. So they're like, you know, they're declaring a word. They're splashing the lions. You know, they got this Babylonian lions coming out of the Fed. And they splash them twice. Now, you would say, oh, that's all in their head. And well, whatever you would say. I don't know, maybe you want. I'm not judging anybody. It was a stretch for me. I'll just make a person. For me, it was, I said, all right, God, all right, I'll get it, but I'll flow. And then we start marching around the building, right, through the march. Now, I don't remember what I saw, but all of a sudden, as we're marching, I'm seeing all these other numbers that God gave me before. I'm like, tripping out, the nines are showing up, and all this other stuff. I haven't even warmed up yet. This gets so much better, trust me. Well, I think it was about a few weeks after that, you had Hurricane Sandy flood New York City. The prophetic act of baptism, God baptized the whole shebang. Only they weren't cursing them. They weren't pulling down strongholds. They were like, Lord, we bless them. And Lord, when you pare down Mystery Babylon, we ask that all the workers would have good jobs and that you would save them. They weren't cursing the Rothschilds and the Rockefellers and all these evil satanic men that have been binding men for years. They were blessing them. Love your enemies. Bless them that persecute you. That say all manner of evil against you, so that you will be perfect as your heavenly Father is perfect. I'm telling you, I've been crying out for love. Every time I miss you with my wife and my kids, honey, I'm sorry, I was not loving. I was not, well, God, I need. But see, I can't love like God loves. Now, here's the word of faith background. The love of God is shed abroad in my heart by the Holy Spirit. See, I'm a big word of faith guy. Only You know, sometimes maybe we'll confess some wealth and stuff. It's okay if it's in the season of the Lord. I'm not going to work any white witchcraft to get what I, my selfish thing wants. But let's not throw out the baby with the bathwater either. God is bringing it to a balance. I am crucified with Christ. Nevertheless, I live. That's my confession. The love of God is shed abroad in my heart by the Holy Ghost. I have the love of God. I have the peace that passes all understanding. You see, and then he gave me the download for heaven, and he gave me the confession. It's happening, and it's happening now. Right. See, man shall not live by bread alone, but every word, the rhema. That's where the true word of faith message is. It's not just working stuff up so I can be a selfish little baby. You said, I am. No. And I don't care who has what, how many roles and private jets, that's not the fruit. And if we keep on looking our eyes at ministries, well, brother so-and-so did it this way, and he got this big old church, and this man did it this way, and he got all, we're missing it. He says, keep your eyes fixed on Jesus, the author and the finisher of your faith. That's who we keep our eyes fixed on. My journey is not your journey. Your journey is not her journey. But we're all journeying to one place, to be conformed into the image of Christ. If we do not have that as our goal, because by the way, that is God's goal, then what are we in this for? You might as well go out and sin and party than believe God for a Rolls, for Pete's sake. Go steal one. Am I right? I don't know. Yeah, I'm crazy.
I feel like the movie Signs down here with all these waters and bottles.
You don't have to drink them all.
Prophetic. Are you guys tracking with me?
Yeah.
Do you feel alive? You guys tracking? Okay, it's going to get better. All right. So I have this dream. I gave the interpretation. Here's where the fun begins. Remember the Matrix movies? All right, those are cool movies. Do you remember the last Matrix movie? It wasn't one of the better ones, but in this Matrix dream world, when he comes out, all of a sudden he's doing the stuff that he was doing when he was in. The stuff started manifesting in real life. First he's in the dream world. Now he's in the real world. All of a sudden, it's on. Well, I have this 999 dream, and about a month after that, I take some of my dinar, and I put it in a safety deposit box. And I write the papers, and she's got the keys, and she walks me into the vault, and I'm just there, and she's opened up the safe. I said, by the way, what's the number on that security box? 999. It gets better. I'm just warming up. Then a few months later, not this past World Series, the World Series before that, the St. Louis Cardinals were about maybe 4 or 5 games out of first place. Had very little chance to get into the World Series. And some crazy lunatic fan, St. Louis Cardinal fan, bets $500 while they're out of first place with only a few games left to win the entire World Series. Well, guess what? They won that year. He placed a $500 bet with Vegas. What do you think the odds Vegas gave him? Somebody just take a wild stab.
999.
Booyah. And he won. Then around the same time, there was an African-American Republican candidate named Herman Cain. Who remembers his tax plan? 999. Then a few months later, now I'm going to share something. This will be a stretch for you. Maybe not. I don't want to assume that, so I don't mean to be prideful. Forgive me. The New Age, okay? The astrologers and the occultists and the Illuminati and all these folks, they have done things. Listen, God is the creator. And there's been so much fear in the church. All that pyramid stuff, all that symbolism. We better. What do you think it means when he says he's the capstone? He's the capstone of the Great Pyramid. That's a truth that I'm just learning. That's been hidden from the church. In fact, my friend Ron O just started talking about, I don't even go there. It's too crazy. I'll mess it all up. He's too nuts for me. I tell him to his face, don't I? I mean that in a good way. He's just way out there. So we have all this stuff in the occult world
That's nothing more than a perversion of truths that have been hidden from the body. And because of fear and religion and tradition,
that's a new age, I don't go there. I don't want to touch that.
But the new agers, they have a lot of revelation, they're just in rebellion. Or they haven't been awakened to the fact that Jesus is the only Christ.
Right.
Okay?
Right.
But, so anyway, so I get an email, back to my little series of signs here, and it was from this, people send all kinds of crazy emails, but I felt like, I'm going to check this one out. It talks about the planet, so I'm watching this guy. I'm not into astrology, okay? But the heavens declare the glory of the Lord. The constellation is the gospel, okay? And the way the planets align and all this stuff, man, you can go there, God is speaking constantly. Now, I'm not wired to constantly see this stuff, but there are people that I'm around are, and it's tripped out, okay? The wise men, they saw what? And they followed the star. See, I believe all these new ages, see, I don't hit them straightforward now. I just tell them my testimony. I said, you're seeking truth. I said, and if you really seek truth, you're going to find truth. Oh, by the way, his name is Jesus. But you keep on seeking, God will get you. God's going to get you. And so, so I get this email, and I listen to this astrology, and it goes, the planets are aligned. Jupiter is over Venus, and these, whatever it was. I'm like, this is whacked. In a 999 configuration. I'm like, what the Dutch? All right, God. All right, this is crazy. Gets better. Everything I just told you, I tell at the dinner table one night with my kids and my little boy, Vincent Jr., he's 6 at the time. This is this past spring, okay, spring of 2012, about April. I just share everything I just shared now. And Vince, you know, he's real deep, he's real quiet, he's super smart, and he's got a real tender, sensitive heart. You know, really unlike his dad in a lot of ways. And my wife looks at him like he's about to say something, and he goes, honey, you want to share something? Go ahead. And his cute little voice, he goes, well... This is right after I shared all this, right? He goes, well, we're of the flesh. We live on the earth, and we're of the flesh. These are thoughts. And God is a spirit, and he lives in heaven. So 999 is a staircase to heaven. And I'm like, this guy didn't listen to Zeppelin? What is he doing? What the heck? He's got some Jimmy Page back there or something? What the? I'm like, this is trippy. I'm already tripped out because I know he said something profound, but I don't have a clue as to what he said. So I handle this with much grace. Well, buddy, I believe God spoke through you, and I'm going to pray that God will show me exactly what you said, but I believe you said something profound. So that night, we watched The Sound of Music. And there, you know, and it's a long movie, so about halfway through they take a pause. And we go have some ice cream, and they have their little dessert. I go on the computer. And I go on the computer, I'm on Yahoo. And you know how it works, you surf, and you see all these little things underneath the main page, and you can, all the little pictures. And I look in the middle, and my jaw drops. It was almost the same experience I had in the safe with the Social Security box. I almost fall out of my chair. Right underneath the little picture, it says 999 steps to heaven.